Works meeting to order. Roll call, please.
Mr. Khan?
Here.
Mrs. Meany?
Here.
Mr. Schmitz?
Here.
Okay, changes to the agenda, there are none. Announcements, there are none. We do have a set of minutes we need to get approved.
I'll make a motion to approve the minutes of March 3rd? No, March 15th. No, March 3rd.
Why do I have March 1st?
First? March 1st, I'm looking at the, that's what it says here.
I have 3-15.
Yeah, okay, March 1st, 2023.
Second.
Okay, I have a motion and a second. Roll call, please.
Mr. Khan?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Schmitz?
Yes.
Okay, moving on to item number two is the storm response status update. Hello, Dennis, and boy, have we had storms. Lordy, lordy.
It's wet. No doubt about that, it's wet. How's everybody doing tonight?
Doing well, thanks, Dennis.
Good, good. My recording date for this is 2/20 to 3/19. At this time, we had 4.22 inches of rain. All of our flood control was taken care of. Only had eight sewer calls. Four were city issues that involved some root cutting. Nothing too bad. Our storm truck at this time has completed the catch basin cleaning in Oakview. Started on Hudson Boulevard and is currently working on the pre-cleaning for the concrete annual. They were doing, on Harper, they were cleaning some basins over there and jetted some laterals due to some heavier debris. Our excavation crew finished our hydrant repair list for the fire department. Eight of them were completed this month and four will need to be replaced by Cleveland Water. We replaced a storm cleanout on Trailwood Court. And our sanitary truck this month, they completed three lift stations. They had five sanitary laterals that were jetted from our PM laterals list. We completed sanitary main cleaning on Meadow Lane buckboard. We just started for the concrete annual and we had nine sanitary work orders that were completed. I'm sure you guys have heard me ramble on about our jobs on Harper Road that we do twice a year. Paul and Stan, close your eyes for this one. Document cam, please. This is on Old Harper. It's a 24-inch sanitary main that comes from Stouffer's. And handy dandy paper clip right here will help me out. This stuff right here, old grease, top, new grease. That's kind of what we're dealing with over there. That does get taken care of twice a year. So just to kind of show people what's going on.
Dennis, if I can, you said it last time that you were there, so it was about as bad as you've ever seen it.
Yeah. Yeah. So.
So it's coming from Stouffer's?
Yeah, is it?
Stouffer's, Harper, what else is on that line? Part of Cannon.
Oh, but bacon grease you were cooking.
Probably, yeah. I'll blame it on my husband.
I mean, that is the reason why we do the PM. That's the reason why we do the PM there. You know, I think we originally had it set up for once a year and then it became twice a year. And, I don't know, I guess we'll have to evaluate to see whether it's might need to be done.
Yeah, it's coming up again this month, so we'll check it again. This was from January, so we'll see what happens.
Okay.
Thanks.
Where else am I? Our TV crew, they have continued their storm main inspection on Somme Hills. We televised a storm main that was not marked on our GIS for the engineering department on Creekside Trail. Winston Lane, we televised a storm easement that was eroding from a catch basin in the backyard. Got that taken care of. On Cromwell, we had storm easement that had some depressions in the backyard, and we televised that for the engineering department. Found nothing at this time. And we began the pre-construction inspection for the concrete annual on Buckboard Lane. So things are starting to pick up. I could answer any questions at this time.
Any questions for Dennis? No, thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, moving on to item number three, the 2023 Infrastructure Improvement Program Monthly Update. Hello, John.
Good evening. John. How's the committee?
Hi, John.
Thank you.
All right, to update the committee from last month in our Priority One projects, as you can see, we show the Miles Road Culvert C13 as awarded in the amount of $197,565.69. And then moving down into our Priority Threes, we show the concrete repair program in the awarded column as well as the street striping. And then moving down into our Priority Threes, we show the previously approved design services as well as the chargebacks. I'm sorry.
Engineering chargebacks. Yeah.
I need my glasses, I guess.
Yes.
But if there's any other questions from the committee, I can address those now.
Well, I guess, you know, the big project, hopefully for this year, will be Aurora Road. Any idea of when that's going to get?
It is currently out for bid.
It is out for bid, okay.
And we had a mandatory pre-bid meeting last Friday.
Okay.
And the bid opening is a week from this Friday.
Oh, boy.
Much interest? Did you have
A lot of interest.
Okay.
Doesn't mean we'll get a lot of bids, but
right.
We've had a lot of interest.
Okay. Okay. Well, that is...
It's going to be a mess.
That's a big one. So it'll be nice to see that one starting to move
so
forward.
So it's good to see that we had a lot of interest.
Right.
Because obviously without a lot of interest, we can't get a lot of bids. So,
right.
But there was a significant amount of interest,
at
least as far as the number of contractors that attended the pre-bid meeting.
Okay. Any idea of the length, how long it's going to take to do that?
Once we really get started on the project, it's slated for about 18 months.
18 months, okay.
The caveat to that is it's all going to be predicated on material supplies.
Right.
Because, as the committee may recall, we are replacing the water line that's in the road, and there's a very, very, very long lead time on ductile iron pipe.
Right. That's what I've heard. Okay. Well, we'll just, I guess, keep our fingers crossed. Okay. Anybody else have any other questions for John? Okay. Okay, moving on then to item number four, the Miles Road Culvert C13 Replacement Project, Contract 2021.25, Northeast Ohio Regional Sewer Division Cost Sharing Agreement.
So in 2013, the City of Solon entered into a regional stormwater management service agreement with the Northeast Ohio Regional Sewer District. And then as part of that agreement, the sewer district provides 25% of the derived revenues to the city to use in any stormwater programs that we choose. We've used this fund once before for the last Miles Road Culvert project that we did with the Village of Orange, and we're proposing to do the same thing with this Miles Road Culvert C13. We have a balance currently in the fund of $15,509.83, and we're proposing to request $15,000 of that account towards our ultimate cost of the Miles Road C13 project, which was previously approved by this committee and City Council in the amount of $197,948.50. In order to do that, the city needs to be able to execute the attached agreement, and the engineering department requests that legislation be prepared authorizing the City of Solon to enter into the agreement with the Northeast Ohio Regional Sewer District to be reimbursed $15,000 from the city's Northeast Ohio Regional Sewer District Community Cost Share account for the Miles Road Culvert C13 project, and to authorize the mayor to sign any and all documents in furtherance of that agreement.
Sounds good. Any questions for, okay, I'll entertain a motion.
Make a motion that legislation be prepared authorizing the city to enter into an agreement with the Northeast Ohio Regional Sewer District to be reimbursed $15,000 from the city's Northeast Ohio Regional Sewer District's community cost share account for the Miles Road Culvert C-13 replacement project.
Second.
Okay, I have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? Roll call, please.
Mr. Khan?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Schmitz?
Yes.
Okay, moving on to item number 5, the Dunedin Avenue Reconstruction Project, Contract 2020.33, General Engineering Design Services, Burgess and Nyepel.
So this is a request to use Burgess and Nyepel to perform design services for the reconstruction of Dunedin Avenue and a portion of Orchard Road. This was, again, another project that our office had intended to do in-house, but due to our staffing issues, we've had to kind of pivot and go in a different direction. The project plan is to reconstruct Dunedin from the intersection up here at Inwood. Down, could I have the document camera zoom out just a little bit, please? Thank you. Okay. The plan is to reconstruct Dunedin Avenue from Inwood Road at the north to Orchard Road at the south and replace the existing water, existing sanitary, and existing storm on Dunedin. And on Orchard Road. This is a little bit different than some of the other ones we've done. This section of Dunedin Avenue has a significant break history for the water line, so we feel it's best to replace it while we're doing the balance of the reconstruction. The engineering department requested Burgess and Nyepel prepare a scope and fee, which is attached and that we've reviewed. Which is in the amount of $156,700. And the engineering department requests that legislation be prepared authorizing the mayor and the engineering department to proceed with the plans and specifications for the Dunedin Avenue reconstruction project with Burgess and Nyepel in the not to exceed amount of $156,700 and to execute all paperwork in furtherance of said work in accordance with the General Engineering Service Agreement.
Any questions for John? I'll entertain a motion.
Okay, I'll make a motion to have legislation prepared authorizing the mayor and the engineering department to proceed with the preparation of plans and specifications for the Dunedin Avenue reconstruction project with Burgess and Nyepel in an amount not to exceed $156,700.
Second.
Okay, I have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? Roll call, please.
Mr. Khan?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Schmitz?
Yes.
Okay, moving on to item number 6, the Aurora Road Reconstruction Phase 1 Project, Contract 2016.19, PID 109517, Right-of-Way Acquisition, Parcel 71, WDT, Request to Amend Ordinance 2022-12.
So City Council previously approved Ordinance 2022-12, authorizing the payment of $25,410 to Eric Lewis for right-of-way acquisition for our Aurora Road project. With any of our right-of-way acquisitions, when they involve a permanent take, we also get a partial release of mortgage because a lot of properties involve mortgages. We've had some situations in the past where we've been taken to court when we haven't had those documents. So we try to secure those for all of our acquisitions moving forward. In the process of getting that partial release of mortgage, the mortgage lender, Rocket Mortgage, has asked for some of that payment, and the engineering department is requesting that Ordinance 2022-12 be amended, authorizing payment to Rocket Mortgage LLC in the amount of $14,876.14. And $10,533.86 to Eric A. Lewis under emergency so that we can complete the acquisition services. The ultimate cost to the city is the same as what was previously approved.
Have we done this? We have never remember us keeping them, or is this just the?
They have occurred, but typically, sometimes when they have occurred in this case, we know going forward when we ask for the original approval.
Okay.
Sometimes you run into these situations.
Sure. Okay.
Unfortunately, these partial releases of mortgages have taken 6 to 12 months to get, and in this case, we had to come back and amend the legislation.
Okay. No problem. Any other questions for John? Okay, I'll entertain a motion.
I'll make a motion that legislation be prepared amending ordinance 2022-12, authorizing payment to Rocket Mortgage LLC in the amount of $14,876.14 and to Eric A. Lewis in the amount of $10,533.86 under emergency so we can complete the acquisition process.
Second.
Okay, I have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? Roll call, please.
Mr. Khan.
Yes.
Mrs. Meany.
Yes.
Mr. Schmitz.
Yes.
Okay, moving on to item number 7, the 2023 Annual Materials Testing Program, Contract 2023.10, Bid Tabulation.
Yeah, so on March 3rd, the city opened bids for our 2023 Materials Testing Program. The apparent low bidder was GeoSci, $99,325. GeoSci has experience with this type of work and has completed this project for the city for several years, as I've noted in my memo. Our estimate was $100,000, and a detailed bid tabulation, which has been checked by the Finance Committee, is attached for the committee's consideration. As I have done in the past, I've provided a cost comparison of GeoSci's previous years, and as you can see, most of their unit costs are the same or similar to those previously provided. So given the favorable outcomes of their previous projects, the Engineering Department recommends that the legislation be prepared awarding the 2023 Annual Materials Testing Program 2023-10 to GeoSci as the lowest and best bidder in the amount of $99,325 under emergency in order to utilize the testing services as soon as possible.
Any questions from the committee? I'll entertain a motion.
All right, I'll make a motion to have legislation prepared awarding the 2023 Annual Materials Testing Program Contract 2023.10 to GeoSci as the lowest and best bidder in the amount of $99,325 under emergency in order to utilize the testing services as soon as possible.
Second.
Okay, I have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? Roll call, please.
Mr. Khan.
Yes.
Mrs. Meany.
Yes.
Mr. Schmitz.
Yes.
Okay, moving on to item number 8, painting of miscellaneous traffic poles and equipment, contract 2023.21, bid tabulation.
Okay, on March 24th, 2023, the city received one sealed bid for our 2023 painting of miscellaneous traffic poles and equipment from Athos Contracting in the amount of $67,000, which was for a base bid and alternate. The low bidder has experience with this type of work as they have completed this project for the city in the past in 2016, and they've also just recently completed our hydrant painting project in 2022. Based on those previous working relationships with the city, we did not check their references. The engineer's estimate for the base bid was $70,000. And a detailed bid tabulation, which has been checked by the Finance Committee, is attached for the committee's consideration. As I noted, we did bid an alternate, which was for to paint a span wire sign pole on Solon Road just east of Somm Center. The base bid is actually to paint quite a bit of the Somm Center corridor poles and traffic cabinets. So we're recommending that alternate be approved, and the engineering department requests that legislation be prepared awarding the base bid and the alternate of the painting of miscellaneous traffic poles and equipment, contract 2023-21 to Athos Contracting as the lowest and best bidder under emergency in order to begin the construction as soon as possible in the amount of $67,000.
Any questions for? Okay, I'll entertain a motion.
I'll make a motion that legislation be prepared awarding the base bid of $64,000 and the alternate of $3,000 of the painting of miscellaneous poles and equipment contract 2023.21 to Athos Contracting as the lowest and best bidder under emergency so we can begin construction as soon as possible.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? Roll call, please.
Mr. Khan?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Schmitz?
Yes.
Okay, moving on to item number 9, the Influent Aerial Sewer Project Contract 2019.24, final change order.
And this is the final change order for the Influent Aerial Sewer Project Contract 2019-24, just at the headworks of the treatment plant. The original contract amount was $621,250 with a substantial completion date of December 7th. There was one previous change order for this contract in the amount of $71,188.51. That revised the current contract value to $692,438.57. The final contract amount is $646,054.95, and the revised completion date is proposed to be September 16th, 2022. Breakdown of the final contract amount and contractor valuation are attached for the committee's consideration. The contractor did substantially complete the project in November of 2021, but there were several items of work that had to be done that were weather dependent and temperature sensitive. As a result, the city finally accepted the project in September of 2022. The engineering department requests that the legislation be prepared approving for this final change order for the Influent Aerial Sewer Project to close out the contract in the amount of $646,054.95 with a revised completion date of September 16th, 2022.
Any questions from the committee? Mm-hmm. I'll entertain a motion.
Okay, I'll make a motion to have legislation prepared approving the final change order for the Influent Aerial Sewer Project to close out the contract in the amount of $646,054.95 and to revise the final completion date to September 16th, 2022.
Second.
Okay, I have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? Roll call, please.
Mr. Khan?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Schmitz?
Yes.
Okay, moving on to item number 10, the 2022 Annual Asphalt Repair Program Contract 2022.08, final change order.
This is the final change order for the 2022 Annual Asphalt Repair Program. The original contract amount was $1,644,607.62 with a completion date of October 31st, 2022. There were no change orders, and not all the estimated quantities for the project were used. The final contract amount ended up being $1,409,998.45. And the original completion date of October 31st, 2022 had to be extended to November 23rd, 2022 due to weather. A breakdown of the final contract amount and the contractor evaluation are attached for the committee's consideration. The engineering department requests that legislation be prepared approving the final change order for the 2022 Annual Asphalt Repair Program to close out the contract in the amount of $1,409,998.45 and to revise the completion date by 23 days from October 31st, 2022 to November 23rd, 2022 due to weather.
Any questions from the committee? Mm-mm. Entertain a motion.
I'll make a motion that legislation be prepared approving this final change order for the 2022 Annual Asphalt Repair Program to close out the contract in the amount of $1,409,998.45 and to revise the completion date by 23 days from October 31st, 2022 to November 23rd, 2022 due to weather.
Second.
Okay, I have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? Roll call, please.
Mr. Khan?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Schmitz?
Yes.
Okay, moving on to item number 11, the painting and miscellaneous traffic poles and equipment, contract 2022.21, final change order.
Okay, this is the final change order for the 2022 painting of miscellaneous traffic poles and equipment. The original contract amount was $76,200 with the original completion date of September 30th, 2022. There were no change orders, and the full amount of the contract was utilized. The completion date ended up or the contractor ended up completing the date before the contractual completion date. A breakdown of the contract amount and the contract evaluation are attached for the committee's consideration. The engineering department requests that legislation be prepared approving the final change order for the painting of miscellaneous traffic poles contract 2022-21 to close out the contract in the amount of $76,200 and with a completion date of September 14th, 2022.
Any questions from the committee? I'll entertain a motion.
All right, I'll make a motion to have legislation prepared approving the final change order for the painting of miscellaneous traffic poles and equipment contract 2022.21 to close out the contract in the amount of $76,200 with the completion date of September 14th, 2022.
Second.
Okay, I have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? Roll call, please.
Mr. Kahn?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Schmitz?
Yes.
Okay, moving on to item number 12, the 2022 hydrant painting contract 2022.23, final change order.
Okay, so this is the final change order for the 2022 hydrant painting contract. The original contract amount was $19,750. There was no change orders on this project. A breakdown of the final contract amount and contractor evaluation are attached for the committee's consideration. The original completion date was September 30th, 2022, but our office made some changes to the hydrant list, which pushed the completion date by $28 to October 28th, 2022. And the engineering department requests that legislation be prepared approving the final change order for the 2022 hydrant painting contract to close out the contract amount in the amount of $19,750 and to revise the final completion date of the project from September 30, 2022 to October 28, 2022.
Any questions from the committee? I'll entertain a motion.
I'll make a motion that legislation be prepared approving the final change order for the 2022 hydrant painting contract 2022.23 to close out the contract in the amount of $19,750 and to revise the final completion date of the project from September 30th, 2022 to October 28th, 2022.
Second.
Okay, I have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? Roll call, please.
Mr. Kahn?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Schmitz?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you.
Thanks, John.
Thanks, John.
Thanks, John.
Moving on to item 13, the on-site construction inspection services. Hello, Dan.
Hello, good evening, everyone.
Hey, Dan.
Hello, Dan.
As the committee is aware, the engineering department uses the services of a qualified inspection firm to supplement our in-house construction staff on an as-needed basis. Last year, we selected GPI as the most qualified firm to provide those services and entered into a one-year renewable contract. The contract provides for two one-year renewable terms, and each of those terms provides for a rate increase equal to the amount that, God bless you, to the amount that our rates, our employees receive raises that year, with the exception of vehicle charge. Vehicle charge is a stable rate. This year, we've budgeted $750,000 for that work, and we've got the Aurora Road project I expect is going to be starting up. GPI has done a very good job providing the services this past year, and they provided very good services on previous LPA projects. Based on that experience, we're recommending that the project would be renewed with GPI and for another additional year with the rate increases, and that the year would be ending May 31st, 2024, and declaring an emergency to provide for continuity of our inspection services for the year.
How long have we been using them, Dan?
Years so far. This would be our fifth year.
Fifth year, okay. Okay. You know, sometimes, I mean, I feel it's good to get it to go out and see if we can get somebody to come in, you know, maybe lower, but I get the relationship, and I think these guys have really worked out quite well.
They have worked out very well, in particular on the LPA projects. Okay. And we did really take a close look at all of the firms that were interested last year.
Okay. Yeah, I know you did. Okay. Yeah. No, I'm good with this. This makes sense. So any other questions from the committee? Okay, entertain a motion.
All right, I'll make a motion to have legislation prepared renewing the Supplemental Inspection Services Contract number 2022.02 with Greenman Peterson Incorporated for one additional year ending May 31st, 2024, and declaring an emergency in order to provide continuity of inspection services for city construction projects.
Second.
Okay, I have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? Roll call, please.
Mr. Khan?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Schmitz?
Yes.
Thanks, Dan.
Thank you.
Thanks, Dan.
Moving on to item 14, authorization to participate in the Ohio Department of Transportation Cooperative Purchasing Agreement for Rock Salt. Hello there, Mr. Dursick.
You okay there, Chairwoman, with the...
I'm fine.
Good.
I'll tell you about your dad one week. It's pretty good back in Ender's Drive.
Yes, every year I come back to the committee this time asking for authorization to participate on behalf of the City of Solon in the ODOT Transportation Purchasing Agreement for Rock Salt, which this year's contract 018-24 for winter use for the 2023-2024 winter season. This year, our participation agreement, along with legislation, has to be submitted no later than May 1st. We've utilized this contract in the past. We've had success with it. They're very responsive, so we don't have any issues with it. And typically, the way this works is all the municipalities and state agencies put together all their salt requirements. They put in a big pot, and then they bid it out. This contract does have a 90% 110 provision in it, so we have to buy at least 90% of what we request, but we can go up to 110% if it's a bad winter. Section 5513.01B of the ORC allows us as a political subdivision to participate in this contract. So I'm requesting authorization on behalf of the City of Solon to participate in the ODOT Cooperative Purchasing Agreement for Salt Contract 1824 for winter use for the winter season. I'm requesting an amount of 10,000 tons this year. I'd like to keep 16,000 total on hand. That way, if we get a bad winter, we have enough between the stock and what we have coming in. Plus, with the upcoming Aurora Road project, I'm assuming we're probably going to use more salt because it's going to be more difficult to plow it with the cuts in the road, potential cuts in the road, and won't be able to plow as much. So we'll have to put a little bit more salt down on the road. And due to the time frame that I have to get this agreement in by May 1st, I'm asking that this be passed under emergency.
So obviously, I mean, we did not have a bad winter. So
no, but we still, we last year our
we have room was, to put.
Right, but last year I had 10,000 right. is our estimate, okay. But we're only going to get by 90% this sure. year. And, you know, typical, you know, even if you get a 1-inch storm, you still have to go out there and salt. It's not like you're not salting and right. you still have to make the road right. safer.
Yeah, no, I get it.
Okay, Mike.
So you mentioned like to keep 16,000 tons on hand. So
well, between what we have in stock, because we have between our three barns, we have about 65,000 to 70,000 tons on hand, and then this supplements it throughout the season.
So is that extra amount on top of the 10,000, or is it on top of 90% of? If that makes
it's
sense,
top of the 10,000. Okay. So the total. Is average. I'd like to keep the 16,000 tons as a good number with, again, with Aurora Road widening, it's extra lane miles, and it's extra salt that has to go down on the roads to keep everybody safe.
And does the salt from previous winters ever expire?
No.
Does it happen? Okay.
No, when we used to purchase the clear lane, I don't know if the past committee members remember that, has an additive to the salt that would actually leak out, and you would see it come out on the ground. And we would capture it, but with the plain rock salt, we don't have those issues. It just gets hard, and we got to bust it up because it clumps because of the moisture.
Okay, any other questions? Okay, then I will entertain a motion.
I'll make a motion that legislation be prepared authorizing the city to participate in the ODOT Cooperative Purchasing Agreement for Sodium Chloride Rock Salt Contract 018-24. For winter use during the 2023-2024 winter season. You need this under emergency?
Yes, I need
okay.
it.
Okay, under emergency so that May we 1st. Can purchase before that May 1st date.
We have to submit before May 1st.
Submit before May 1st.
Second.
Okay, I have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? Roll call, please.
Mr. Khan?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Schmitz?
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. Okay, moving on to item 15, requesting legislation be prepared accepting the bid from ESK Landscaping for the 2023 mulching services contract. Hi, Mark. Or no, hi, Dennis.
Hi.
I look up to see. I just was assuming it would be Mark. But that's okay. I like having you.
On Friday, March 10th, bids were received for the 2023 mulching services contract for the service department. Four official bids were received for the contract. After review of all the bids by service and finance, ESK Landscape was the lowest and best bidder for the contract. This contract is for a four-year period from 2023 to 2026 for a full mulching of selected city properties in 2023 and 2025, and a touch-up of city properties in 2024 and 2026. The total cost of the four-year contract is $71,155. This was included in the 2023 approved budget under professional services. Service is requesting to have legislation prepared under emergency to accept ESK Landscaping as the awarded bidder for the 2023 mulching services contract. To utilize this contract as soon as possible.
Any questions from the committee? Mm-hmm. Okay, we'll entertain a motion.
Okay, we'll make a motion to have legislation prepared under emergency to accept ESK Landscaping as the awarded bidder for the 2023 mulching services contract in the amount of $71,155 and to utilize this contract as soon as possible.
Second.
Okay, I have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? Roll call, please.
Mr. Kahn?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Schmitz?
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Moving on to item 16, the 2023 Annual Industrial Surcharge Rate Review. We have Clint with us tonight. Hello.
Hello, good afternoon, or good evening.
Stan.
As you are aware, the City of Solon charges industrial sewer users surcharges for stronger than average strength wastewater discharge to the sanitary sewer system to reflect the additional cost of treating that wastewater. Annually, we look at our cost structure and review that rate, our cost versus the rate structure, and make our recommendations based on that for modifications or adjustments to those rates. We completed that adjustment last month, or review last month, I should say, and have some rate history here. I'll review with you. Let's go with this one first. As you can see, this is about an eight-year rate history on our costs versus the actual rate, looking at things like the top one here is our BOD surcharge. I beg your pardon, that's our oil and grease surcharge. The green one would be the suspended solid surcharge, and then the red is the BOD surcharge. You can see a large spike up a few years ago reflecting construction spending. At that time, we really didn't recommend adjusting rates based on that because of we wanted stable rates for our industry. We've worked through those cost swings, so now we're seeing it more stable. And you can see on each of these graphs, for instance, with respect to oil and grease rates here, the light blue line is our actual rate versus the calculated rate is the darker blue line, very close. And that's true of the others as well on this graph. We've been very active in trying to maintain costs and limit our spending, and we're effective in doing that. So those rates are very stable. Looking at some additional costs rates here, you can see the greeners are ammonia surcharge rate. Again, very stable. Our actual rate is very close to the calculated rate right there. But for the phosphorus rate, we're seeing a pretty significant increase in our costs that is not reflected in our current rate structure. These costs went up about 40% or 50% last year for ferric chloride, which was the major contributor to that. This is a commodity chemical that, with the economic trends in the country, has gotten more expensive, and so it's raised our costs. As I said, for our ferric chloride, about 40% last year. We're under a two-year contract that will expire at the end of this year. And I did some research looking at current pricing and saw where municipalities were paying an additional 50% rate increase from where we are currently, that we will likely be facing when we renegotiate or go out for bid on this contract next year. So based on all that, we recommend, or we are requesting legislation to revise the ordinance to reflect the industrial surcharge rate increase for phosphorus from a $1.912 per pound to $2.073 per pound. There we go. About an 8% increase. Be happy to answer any questions from the committee.
Any questions? I mean, I guess mine is really only comment. I think you've kept this. You know, we really haven't raised, right?
No, we've maintained very stable rates for the last, I would say, 10 years or so. We've really kept them very, very small increases overall.
We did raise surcharge rates last year. Again, just the trend is going up. I think we raised it on BOD and suspended solids and phosphorus. But again, as Dan said,
right,
we're seeing the over in the industry that we can probably potentially figure that there's going to be an increase in what we're going to pay for ferric chloride, another 50% on top of the 40% to 50% increase that we saw last contract. So. It's just reflective of the market. Everything is just skyrocketing.
Yeah, I think, you know, it's certainly, you know, more than understandable that, you know, at some point we have to, you know, offset some of the costs onto the users. So.
Mm-hmm. And again, these are just surcharge rates. These aren't our user rates, so it's really only affecting our industry. And correct me if I'm right, Stan, there's only one or two industries that are really going to be affected by this cost increase.
Yeah, the phosphorus in particular, the surcharge isn't too widespread, so it is two industries that will be impacted.
Okay. And you get in touch with them? And
yeah, or yes. Yeah, they know it's coming.
They know it's coming, yeah, for sure.
When you say industries, do you mean businesses, or do you mean like a group of businesses within the same industry?
It would be a single entity in a manufacturing process, typically, that would have these surcharges. So a company, one of the ones in question here would be a metal finisher that treats metal using a phosphate compound, would have, in this case, a phosphorus surcharge.
Okay.
Okay. There's no other questions or comments. I'll entertain a motion.
I'll make a motion that legislation be prepared, amending codified ordinance chapter 1046.04 to reflect the industrial surcharge rate increase for phosphorus from $1.912 per pound to $2.073 per pound under emergency.
Second.
Okay, have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? Roll call, please.
Mr. Kahn?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Schmitz?
Yes.
Okay, moving on to item 17, the aeration diffuser bid. Hi, Paul.
Good evening.
Hey, Paul.
Great to be back. Good evening. Okay, as the committee is aware, we went out for bid for our aeration diffusers. I think I requested going out to solicit bids back in December 2022. Unfortunately, you see how long it takes to make things happen. but on February 24th, we opened the bids. Unfortunately, there was only one bid. In this current situation, we've only have two suppliers that can supply bids. And the one bid that we did receive was from Environmental Dynamics International, EDI, in the amount of $141,459. The bid met all required specifications. We did contact references, and everyone contacted was very happy with the quality of their product and their service. We did contact the other manufacturer that could have supplied these diffusers, and unfortunately, they said they just forgot about the bid, which is very disheartening because they are the manufacturer who we currently have installed. So based on that, we have a limited amount of time to try to get this done within the year. I know the committee doesn't like to get one bid, but, you know, in this situation, we want to try to get this. We've had this on the schedule to try to get done in the last 3 years, and we have the opportunity to try to get it done this year. The estimated delivery time is 16 to 18 weeks, so the sooner the better if we go ahead and do that. So my job tonight is to try to convince you that we've only got one bid, but we need to go forward with it. We vetted as much as we can, and I believe it's the best bid moving forward. Therefore, to complete this project, we are recommending legislation to accept the bid from Environmental Dynamics International in the amount of $141,459, and to do this on emergency legislation so we can try to get this done this year. You know, our time frame, really when the plant runs the best, is between August and September. So if we can try to get it done in that time frame, everything will be ideal. If we have to extend it to September a little bit, we'll probably be okay. But if it actually goes beyond that, we're probably going to have to wait till next year. Okay. Just because, you know, we might be put ourselves in jeopardy of violation of the permit, because we actually have to take aeration tanks down to do this.
Gotcha. Okay. Yeah, like I say, you always like to see more than one bid, but in this situation where I don't think there's a whole lot of...
Mm-hmm. They didn't, I guess they didn't, need the, they didn't need the work.
Right.
So, wow. Yeah, like I say, I'm fine with this, Paul.
Okay.
I get it. I don't know if there's any other comments or questions from the committee. Are you okay? All right, I'll entertain a motion.
All right. We'll make a motion to have legislation prepared accepting the bid from Environmental Dynamics International in the amount of $141,459. To purchase new ceramic diffuser heads and spare parts for the aeration system and declaring an emergency.
Second.
Okay, I have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? Roll call, please.
Mr. Kahn?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Schmitz?
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, moving on to projects and reports. Item 18, which is the Engineering Department Study Design Report.
Yeah, the committee has my report, and I can answer any questions you may have. A couple of things I want to highlight for the committee is just to reiterate that the Aurora Road project is out for bid, and that bid opening is April 14th. One other thing is I think at the last meeting I had talked to the committee about how the engineering department was applying for municipal bridge funds for our Enterprise Parkway mm-hmm. culvert replacement project, that we did submit that application, and we had an virtual interview with ODOT earlier this week. We're hopeful to find out whether or not we got the project funded or not, either by the end of April or early May. And one last thing is that in addition to the Aurora Road project, our annual catch basin program is out for bid.
Okay.
So if there's any other questions from the committee, I can address those now.
Bob?
Have you heard anything from Dominion about Solon Road?
We have, and I'll defer that to Dan when he has his presentation.
Okay.
Mike? Any idea when the Miles Road retaining wall might be stained?
I don't. I would assume as soon as the weather is conducive to the paint temperatures, it will be done.
It's quite nice today.
It was.
I know we need 5 days.
Okay. Thanks, John. Okay, moving on to item 19, the construction report, April 5th, 2023. Hi, Dan.
We'll go right to supplemental inspection services. We don't use that very much during the winter, but we have a balance remaining on that of $584,261. And then our emergency road repair, this is the first month for our emergency road repair program, and what you see here is $71,925 of expenditures, and there's honestly another break this past month that doesn't show on here that was on Miles Road. We'll report that next month, but honestly, it's about another $23,000. So leaves us with the remaining balance before the Miles Road project of $406,629. And then I guess with regard to Solon Road, The Dominion Betterment Project on Solon Road, there's going to be a pre-construction walkthrough of the project tomorrow that had been delayed maybe about, I don't know, 6 weeks because of some issues that they had with getting clearance from the railroad to work in that area. But we expect that now work's going to get started and get going and eventually clear the way for our Solon Road Improvement Project. I'd be happy to answer any other questions you have.
Any questions for Dan?
It'll be nice to get that one rolling. Yeah. Solon Road is just awful.
It is bad. It's really like, oh. Yeah, there's certainly, you just feel like you're going to be flying over the. Mm-hmm. Okay. Thanks, all right, Dan. Thanks, Dan.
You're welcome.
Okay, moving on to item 20, the Sanitarium Storm Repair Program Report.
Yes, we started off with $300,000 on the contract. We have held back $12,367.33 in retainage. I have a few more bills that need to be taken care of, but as of right now, we have an estimated balance left for this contract of $97,509.83. And our new contract should be starting already, so I can answer anything at this time.
Any questions from Dennis? Okay. Thank you. Okay, moving on to item 21, the Water Reclamation Progress Report.
Just to bring the committee up to date on the construction, the concrete project, we do have the first phase of the flooring poured. That was successful. Moving on to phase two, this phase one actually took a lot longer than the contractor anticipated, but they still feel that they can meet the scheduled deadline, so we'll keep our fingers crossed. We're doing everything we can to try to accommodate giving them sections of the building that we can afford to give them to keep them moving forward. So everything's looking good so far. There, you know, it's been a challenge for the contractor as far as, you know, there's been some things that we came across that we were able to rectify with the engineer as far as getting extra beams put in place and things of that nature. And I think I mentioned that to the committee before that we were able to work this out. We are keeping track of what's a change order and the give and takes, and so far we're doing very well on that.
Oh, good.
So we'll keep you apprised.
Great.
Well, that can answer any questions you might have.
Yeah. Okay. Any questions for Paul? Okay, great. Thank you. And then the Service Department monthly report, Dennis.
Our committee has Mark's report. I can answer anything at this time.
Any questions for Mark? Okay, moving on to correspondence. I do want to bring something up that was mentioned at this previous council meeting and kind of throw it out to everybody. Probably Dan, mostly you. I think there was a comment about, you know, notifying residents when work is going to be done. And I know in the past we have, you know, put it, you know, somewhat on the contractors. I do know when we, like, we'll do residential streets, whether, you know, the concrete replacement or whatever, you know, we would have, you know, meetings with the residents. We would have them come in. I don't know. I mean, I personally thought that was the best thing because the contractor knows when they're going to work. I don't know if there's anything really the city can do, you know, until we can get, I think, our communication better through technology, which we should be able to do, but so far that doesn't seem to be able, you know, that we still just really aren't able to communicate that way with our residents. But, you know, I don't expect any, I don't know how the committee feels about this, but, you know, certainly I think, you know, if people know what's going to be happening, obviously, then they're aware. And I don't know if it's better, you know, for the city to take over it. Again, I think you guys have a whole lot on your plate. And like I say, I think in the past, I certainly have never gotten complaints that people weren't aware. You know, maybe on a few occasions, oh, they didn't realize they were coming or they were going to be changing the side of the street. You know, these are more in repair programs, street repair programs. But I don't know how you guys feel. Like, is this something maybe we should reevaluate? And John, go ahead.
To add to that discussion, And I was there at the council meeting to hear what council said. But I'll give you just a recent example of where I think it might be in the city's best interest to still allow the contractor to do those notices. For instance, for the city's Forest Glen tree replacement project that was awarded, the contractor was going to start work on a Monday.
Right.
And our office sent out just a general notification in late the previous week with the understanding that the contractor was going to start on Monday,
mm-hmm.
knowing that by either Saturday or before they would get that notice. Well, the contractor, unbeknownst to the city, decided he had an opening in his schedule, showed up unannounced Friday morning, and started working. Now, they handed out notices,
right.
but to my point, is then the city's notice got there late of that contractor working, which can lead to a whole bunch of other questions and suggestions that the city doesn't know what our contractor's doing and we're not being good stewards of our projects.
Right. Yeah, no, I get it. That's why I said I think, you know, I think that what we do now of having the contractor, because they know what their schedule is, which can change, like I say, with weather and everything else they have. So I understand and appreciate what you're saying.
Now, to the point of the city sending out notices, we do send out notices for a lot of our other larger projects, for instance, like the concrete annual and the asphalt annual, but they're very generalized with no dates set in them, just saying, hey, your street is is on our list to do work this year. And that's pretty much all it does. And Dan prepares a nice little notice, you know, kind of what to expect brochure that goes
right.
with it.
Right.
But we don't publicize any dates or anything in that.
I get
only
that.
That the work is anticipated to come up this year.
Yeah, I just don't know what the answer is, Bob. You had a
just a comment. You know, going with that incident that occurred, you know, even if they were notified of the project, it would have made no difference. There's, you know, it still had a fume issue. If they had dry traps, they're still going to, even if they knew about it,
mm-hmm.
it really wouldn't have made any difference.
Mm-hmm.
They still would have had the problem.
Yeah.
I think the biggest concern was, you know, again, I don't expect you just to answer the phones as soon as they show up or call. Everybody's busy. I mean, yeah, there's other things going on, you know, but as long as the calls are returned in a fairly timely manner, I think, the way it sounded to me is there was some misinformation, not from our guys, just
right.
what the resident
mm-hmm.
thought was,
yeah.
I don't know where he got his information from. You know, it didn't make any sense to me from what I heard. Been there, done this, you know. So I've played with those meters. I know what they're talking about. You know, so it's just a matter of, you know, as long as we get back to our residents when they have these concerns and stuff like that, that's probably the biggest thing.
Mm-hmm.
And I agree that I really am sure that we do. I don't have a problem with this.
Yeah, it was brought up by someone on council, I think, about maybe, you know, maybe we should be notifying them. And I think,
it
you know.
It would have made no difference, though.
Right. And to John's point, and I'm sure, Dan, you could concur with this because you're, you know, the more kind of on-the-ground person during these kind of projects is, you know, like I say, we don't know exactly. We can let them know, hey, your street's going to be done, but it's really up to the contractor.
Mm-hmm.
I know in the past, the concrete, it's been trying more. They've been very good. All my residents have always been happy with them. They communicate. They let them know. And I just don't see what more the city can do or that being our responsibility. Because as John brought up, you know, if somebody has a break, we're going to want them to come in and do the work,
mm-hmm.
get the work done. You know, I mean, we're so limited in our climate here that I'm just not sure. But I just wanted to put it out there because personally, I'm comfortable with the way it's set up now. I think,
right.
like I say, the city does. It sends out, you know, Dan, you're a little, you know, what to expect when you have construction on your street. I mean, I think it's great. And most of the residents, you know, certainly of mine, I can only speak for my residents, you know, have been very pleased and have understood what, you know, have an idea of what's going to happen.
Yeah.
As long as
they're aware.
To be able to, you know, to put it on the city to pinpoint, okay, we're going to be there, you know, Monday at 9:05 is,
right.
you know,
that's asking too much.
Yeah, I mean, unless we ourselves internally are doing the project, you know, maybe we could do that, but, you know, other than that. So I wanted to put it out there because obviously, I know, obviously, John and Bill were at the council meeting and, you know, that was mentioned, well, you know, the city needs to be doing that. And I, like I say, I somewhat disagree because I think what we do is, you know, more than adequate. And the contractor, and yes, there will be times maybe the notice, you know, gets dropped or isn't seen or whatever, you know, that can happen. We can't control all of that. Mm-hmm. You know, like I say, I think if we could work on our communication where we could, you know, be able, you know, they could, you know, get to Danette, hey, hit out this, you know, where we had access, you know, to our residents and say, hey, they're going to be coming, you know, that would be a beautiful thing, and hopefully at some point that can happen. I know you've been working on that, Mike, right?
Yes, sure.
Yeah, thank you for letting me, but I just wanted to put it out there. I thought, you know, this is a proper committee. This is what we do. So as far as I'm concerned, I think what we have set up right now is more than adequate, and I don't see any reason to change it. Bill?
The only thing I'd like to add to that with regards to the incident is, you know, the homeowner did email John, and John was back to them that day in an email. May not have gotten the communication back via phone call, but John did return his email because he copies me practically on everything he sends out. So yeah, just want to make that clear to everybody.
I was aware of that.
You know, John, if you would have went out there.
Mike.
Do we ask our contractors to notify the residents before they begin their projects?
Yeah, and in this particular case, there was a 24-hour notification that we changed the dates, but Dan, you know, looks over those notifications, and then it's up to the contractor to get them out the day before. And, you know, I do have copies of all that if the committee would like to see that specific notification.
The one thing I noticed was he mentioned, that resident mentioned that when he contacted his council person, Jeremy, that Jeremy wasn't even aware that it was going on. Now, I don't need notification personally, but it puts me in an embarrassing state when I find out about city news from a resident, you know, and this isn't saying anything towards it, because personally for me, I really don't need to know. And actually, I think you do a pretty good job in notifying when things are going on, even beyond just construction. Like, you do a good job with that. But I did feel bad for Jeremy there, having to tell a resident that, oh, I wasn't even aware that this was happening. And I've been put in that situation before, and mm-hmm. it looks like we don't know what's going on, even though we probably, there shouldn't be an expectation that we know everything going on.
We trust them. That, yeah. That's what, you know.
Right, exactly.
You know, for a catch basin repair or something like that, I wouldn't expect to,
exactly.
You know, to be notified, hey, they're going to be on in your ward on X Street.
Right.
And, but if there's an issue.
Yeah.
That something happens, it wouldn't be
a
bad thing.
And I think you guys are pretty good about, I mean, I know in the past I've gotten notices, hey, there was this incident, you know, in your ward at XYZ. And, you know, I think that's as far as us,
sure.
You know, council, you know, those would be the things, you know, I mean, there may be other council people who really want to be notified of every single thing, every project, and I'll leave that up to them to discuss that with you. But, you know, as far as changing any sort of policy, you know, I'm good with what we have, and I think what we have, you know, really on the whole works well.
Mm-hmm. So. Yep. Carry on.
You guys do a great job. You know, we have a lot of stuff going on in this town, so we some really big projects, and they're all done very well. So, okay, moving on. Okay, I guess I was the correspondent. So I'll entertain a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Roll call, please.
Mr. Kahn?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Schmitz?
Yes.